Well, good morning. Good morning to all of you. If you and I have not met, my name's Todd Brown. I'm the minister here. And I'm sure some of you are sitting here thinking we're getting ready to show you Spider-Man or Captain America. No, we've been getting a new series in January called The Amazing Jesus. And we'll get to that in just a minute. You know, America's appetite for superhero seems insatiable. Everyone is attending the movies. They're buying the toys for their kids, reading the comic books, superheroes. I just wonder, who is your favorite superhero? Don't be ashamed. Yell it out. Who's your favorite superhero? Wonder Woman. Wait, what was in the back? Juggernaut. All right. Anyone else? Hulk. Supergirl. Flash. Captain America. Okay, yeah.
Thor.
Yeah. Todd. Yeah. You know, they have put superheroes in teams. And I wonder which is your favorite team. There's the X-Men, there are the Avengers, Justice League. Who's your favorite team? The Avengers? Yeah. Let me tell you who mine is. May I humbly suggest? The Dallas Cowboys. Yeah. But the greatest superhero of all time, and I mean no disrespect here, the prototypical superhero of all time, of course, is the amazing Jesus. The amazing Jesus. How many of you have seen Aquaman? Is it good? I read Aquaman comic books when I was a little boy. We have a picture of him. There he is, right there, Aquaman. And he does look a little like me, I think, don't you? If you follow Aquaman, you know that he has telepathic skills. His superpower is that he can call all the fish of the sea to do his bidding. Now, where have you seen that before? Jesus, the amazing Jesus. Did it not only once, but twice. You can read about it. Luke 5, John 21. And this amazing Jesus could walk on water. He could read minds. He could see the future. He could calm storms. He could walk through walls. He could communicate with angels and demons. He could come back from the dead, and his last act was flying through the clouds, returning to heaven. You talk about superhuman. You talk about superpowers, supernatural. You talk about a superior man. You talk about a superlative savior. Jesus was and is super amazing. This amazing story of Jesus starts with him hiding in plain sight. You see, that's what superheroes do. Remember Clark Kent? They hid in plain sight, and then they became the superpower Jesus, living in a little dusty town, Nazareth. He was perfectly disguised as a carpenter, the oldest of at least six other children, running the family business. But when it came time for him to show the world who he was, to begin his ministry, those friends, those neighbors, that little town was overwhelmed. Look at Matthew 13, 54. It's on the screen behind me. Matthew 13, 54. Coming to his hometown, he began teaching the people in their synagogue, and they were amazed. Where did this man get this wisdom and these miraculous powers? They asked, isn't this the carpenter's son? Isn't his mother Mary, and aren't his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas with us? Did you know that in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, those four different authors will use the same key word to describe people's attitude about Jesus. And that word is amaze, amazing, amazement, 35 times between the four Gospels. They were amazed. I hope you have something to write with. I'm going to click through some scriptures. We're going to take a quick tour through the Gospels real quick. I'll go so fast you won't be able to turn there. But here we're going to take a look at some of Jesus' superpowers and people's amazement. He was powerful over nature. Do you remember when he calmed the storm on the Sea of Galilee? He had his disciples with him in the boat. A huge squall came up. He replied, "You of little faith, why are you so afraid?" Then he got up, rebuked the wind and the waves, and it was completely calm. The men were amazed and asked, "What kind of man is this? Even the winds and the waves obey him." Jesus had power over disease. You might remember this story from Mark chapter 2. A man he healed, he had been crippled since birth. "I tell you, get up, take your mat and go home." The man got up, took his mat and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone. And they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." Jesus had power over demons. And he cast out demons not just once, but many times. One is recorded in Luke 11:14. Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. That is, he'd made the man mute. When the demon left, the man who had been mute spoke, and the crowd was amazed. And then you might not think it a superpower, but he had supernatural teaching. This was a carpenter who grew up in a little hick town, who knew the past, the present, the future. He understood the hidden things of God and taught about it. John 7:14. Now about halfway through the festival, Jesus went to the temple courts and began to teach. The Jews there were amazed and asked, "How did this man get such learning without having been taught?" Amazing miraculous power, amazing superhuman strength, amazing otherworldly authority. Jesus was out of this world amazing. And who ever has been? Who is, whoever will be like him? Who lived before time began? Who created the universe along with his Father? Who came to earth to demonstrate both God's love and power? Who was put to death by the very ones he came to save, yet rose from the dead 3 days later? Who has ascended through the skies, through the clouds, back to heaven? Who is making a home for us there? Who will come again, raising the dead, assembling us all together into those clouds of glory? Who will judge the world in righteousness? Who will conquer sin and death forever? And who will for eternity reign as King of Kings and Lord of Lords? Tell me, who is his equal? Who is his rival? Well, what about Superman? Take a look at this.
Faster than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings at a single bound.
Look, up in the sky, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman, strange visitor from another planet who came to Earth with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men. Superman, who can change the course of mighty rivers, bend steel in his bare hands, and who, disguised as Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for a great metropolitan newspaper, fights a never-ending battle for truth, justice, and the American way.
That was the Superman I grew up with. Any of the rest of you grow up watching George Reeves, I was the actor, play Superman? Yeah, wow, I'm old. That guy was super. By the way, to stand there and be photographed in his long underwear, that took some strength, didn't it? Superman. What a compelling, interesting, intriguing, mysterious story. In the minds of popular culture, Superman's story is unsurpassed in intrigue and wonder. Someone has suggested that Superman may be the most fascinating fictional character of the last 75 years. His story has been told and retold. His outfit is one of the most recognized icons worldwide. I did some research. Since 1941, there have been 11 full-length Superman movies. George Reeves, this black and white repeating episodes of Superman, there were 104 of those television shows. There have been dozens more television shows, hundreds of Superman cartoons, thousands of comic books, a million Halloween costumes. But to people who know the story of Jesus, the story of Superman is very familiar. There's a book I want to show you. The author is Stephen Skelton. The title of the book is The Gospel According to the World's Greatest Superhero. And Skelton, who admits, I just love superheroes, started noticing the comparisons between Jesus and Superman. And so he really went back and he read hundreds, thousand comic books, did the research, and said, without a doubt, the story of Superman and Jesus are connected. Not just similar, but connected to the creators of Superman, Jerry Siegel and Joel Shuster, who created Superman in 1930. The story of Jesus was the template for Superman. Superman is really a modern retelling of that old gospel story. Think about it. You understand what incarnate means, God becoming flesh, Emmanuel, God with us. Superman, a man within some boundaries of our human experience and yet possessing supernatural qualities. I found this very interesting in my own reading. Superman's father's name was Jor-El. Jor-El. Now remember, the creators of Superman were Jewish. Jor-EL. EL is a Jewish word for God. It is the word connected to the man's name, Jor-El, Jor-God. It's implying that Jor-El was God or a God. Jor-El's son, who we call Superman, had a name, a Kryptonian name Kal-El, K-A-L-E-L, Kal-El. Now, if you're not Jewish, you wouldn't pick this up. I didn't know this. Kal-El literally means then the son of Jor-El, the son of God. Skelton goes on to say, Superman's story goes something like this. From above, a heavenly father sends his only son to save the earth. When he comes to earth, he'll be raised by two parents who originally had the names, you're not going to believe this, originally, you know what their names were? Mary and Joseph. Now, this is the Superman story we're talking about. Skelton goes on, when Superman comes of age, he travels to the Arctic wilderness to commune with his father's spirit, which mirrors Christ's journey into the desert for 40 days. At age 30, Superman will embark on his public mission. This is the same age as Christ when he began his ministry. Then Superman will, in his mission, fight for truth and justice, two fundamental biblical principles. By the way, two very Jewish fundamental principles, truth and justice. Skelton concludes, within the specifics of that story, I know of no other story that mirrors it so closely than the Christ story. Now, Christopher Reeve, the old black and white, George Reeves, rather, was the Superman I grew up with. Some of you grew up with Christopher Reeves as your Superman. Who remembers the Christopher Reeve movies? Yeah, more hands. Yeah. You might remember in the very first movie, his father and mother sending him to Earth. Do you remember? And I will give you today's offering if you can tell me the actor who played Superman's dad. Do you remember? Pardon me? Well, since there's a tie, I can't. Sorry. Yes, Marlon Brando played Jor-El. Think about that for a minute. The Godfather played Jor-El. There is a quote from that first movie. Listen to this. Even though you have been raised by a human being, you are not one of them. They can be a great people, Kal-El. They wish to be. They only lack the light to show the way. For this reason, above all, their capacity for good, I have sent them you, my only son. The story of Superman might speak to the human heart in such a compelling way because our hearts long for a savior, for the security of knowing somewhere watching over us is someone bigger, wiser, stronger, someone supernatural. Jesus Christ is that someone. I'm not trying to be flippant when I say he is the real Superman, and he had the capacity to do real miracles. He was a real person who really lived, and those who knew him and saw him and were touched by him were amazed. And he had a great capacity, a supernatural ability to love. And to love the unlovely. You talk about supernatural love. When he was being crucified by the Romans on a cross. Given over by his own countrymen, by the way. Deserted by his own followers. Betrayed by one of his own. As he was lifted up on that cross, he said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." We long for someone to come and rescue and come and save. And Jesus has done that. And if you're a believer today, you are longing for someone yet to come to mightily overthrow the enemies of God, to set things right, to put things in order, to answer our questions, to avenge us of our enemies, yet lovingly administer truth and justice. Would you very quickly turn to the book of Zephaniah in the Old Testament? It's in the closing pages of the Old Testament. You may have never found that little book. I wish you would. Will you find it? Zephaniah was a prophet, and God spoke through Zephaniah about the coming of the Christ. But Zephaniah had a vision beyond the Christ child and the manger. He saw the very last day of history when Christ would come in the clouds. He would call him Lord and God, but he saw what we are longing for, the second coming of Christ. This is a beautiful passage. Zephaniah 3:17, speaking of the Christ, "The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing." Isn't that a beautiful prophecy? The mighty warrior is coming. Think of the closing images of the book of Revelation, when Christ, with a robe dipped in blood, leading the armies of heaven, and on his name, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, a powerful sword coming from his mouth, when he will make things right on that great day. And the dead will rise, will be assembled in the clouds. He will cleanse the earth, and then he will establish his kingdom. And when we are all assembled, the first order of business, he will sing. He will sing over us. It's what he's been looking forward to. It's the day he's been waiting for, when he will come for his bride and he will usher in eternity with a love song for his people. What a scene. Now I believe that we will be so overwhelmed at that day. We will be so overwhelmed when we hear our Savior singing a love song over us, that the people of the world, the risen saints who have been reunited with dead loved ones forever, will burst into song. What will it be? The Hallelujah Chorus, Amazing Grace, a song we don't yet know? As I was thinking about it just this morning, I was reminded of this old hymn that I sang in my father's church as a child. Some of you will remember it. "I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner, condemned, unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful. And my song shall ever be, how marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. If you're a guest today, I want you to listen very carefully, because I want you to know that at about this time in our service every Sunday, we worship through a communion service every Sunday. At this point, the lights will be dimmed, some soft music will be played. There's some instructions that will appear on the screen over my shoulder. We're going to partake together a simple meal, a piece of bread, a cup of grape juice, representing the body and the blood of Jesus. It's not an elaborate thing we do, but it's purposeful, it's meaningful. It's a very quiet meal that you will take by yourself as we share together corporately in it. It's between you and Jesus. And this morning, as we partake together, I want you to admit to him, to confess to him, I am unworthy, I'm a sinner, unclean. But I will accept your promise of amazing grace, amazing love. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, we pause now in our busy lives. We just give you these next few moments and ask you to visit us. You've been here since the very beginning of this service. You preceded us into this room. You've manifested yourself through our music. You've spoken to us through your word. And now, Holy Spirit, would you speak to our hearts? Would you remind us that we are all lost without Jesus? We all had a debt we could never repay without Jesus. And we were never going to receive a grace apart from his amazing grace that would forgive us and save us. We are unworthy to be called heavenward. But Holy Spirit, would you remind us that that was the mission, that was the purpose. Lord Jesus, as we journey back in our mind to your cross and we see you there suffering on our behalf, we are just overwhelmed and grateful. Heavenly Father, would you do something new in us? Would you create a greater awareness, a greater hunger and thirst for righteousness in us here at the beginning of this new year? As we commune with you, would you commune with us? Lord Jesus, amen.